Hello, anatomists and physiologists. Michele Glass here, and welcome back to another one of our videos for chapter one. The topic for this video are those 11 body systems. So when we left off, we were talking about the organization of the body, starting with that chemical level, moving to the cells, tissues, organs, and organ systems. And that's exactly where we're picking up with this particular video here. So let's start with what we call the integumentary system. And as we look at each body system, we want to look at, you know, what we would call our anatomy, which remember is talking about structures, and then our physiology, which remember is talking about job, right? So when we talk about the integumentary system, we'll see that this consists of the skin, the hair, the nails, and the glands. Now, glands is a huge category. This could be sweat glands. This could be sebaceous glands. This could be seruminous glands, which are the glands inside your ear that's making earwax. So there's quite a lot of glands. There's quite a lot in this particular category. Now, your textbook makes this great point that as we look at body systems, we can't say, oh, these are the organs of that system, because very often organs will be involved in multiple systems. So we'll talk about that a little bit more as we move on. But a good example here would be your mammary glands are going to be, you know, technically a part of the integumentary system, but we think about them more in relationship to reproductive systems. So we'll see some examples like that. The key job for the integumentary system is going to be protection. So I like to kind of have a single word or short phrase to help jog my memory, and that's what I use for the job of the integumentary system. Now, this is going to be involved in like thermoregulation. So that means both keeping the body cool and also keeping the body warm. You're going to have sensory reception here. That's one of the jobs of the hair. You're going to have protection against pathogens entering, or chemical abrasion. You have protection from UV radiation. And this is just kind of a brief summarized list. So we'll be spinning a whole chapter on the integumentary system, and at that point we'll dig deeper, right? So this is a really good introduction. The next system that we can look at is the skeletal system, and we'll do the same thing where we have anatomy or structures on one side and then physiology or function on the other. So here with your skeleton, your bones are going to be the main organ that you'll think about, but you also have important connective tissues called ligaments. So your ligaments are going to anchor your bones to your bones. We also have cartilages. So we'll be talking about hyaline cartilage when we get into our lab. And we also have what's called fibrocartilage. That's gonna be important with our joint structures as well. So we'll see both of those. Skeletal system, I would say here the big phrase is support. So it's going to be providing leverage for muscle movement. It's going to be providing just like a framework for the whole body. So this is a hard structure that our soft tissues can attach to and kind of be wrapped around, right? It's going to also, you know, have a protective functions as well. It's going to protect some internal organs, such as your skull protecting your brain, or your rib cage protecting your heart and lungs. When we talk about the muscular system, we're talking about what we call our skeletal muscle. So this is the muscle that is attached to your skeleton. And there are some connective tissues here as well. So we can talk about tendons as being those tissues that connect the muscle to the bone. When we talk about the job of the muscular system, I would like you to remember movement as your catchphrase or easy to remember one word answer. But there's a little more that's happening here. So we can see thermoregulation as part of this system as well. So we'll see if our body is cold, that we can generate heat through skeletal movement. So that might be actually just getting up and walking around, or that might be shivering that's happening there, right? We're going to also see some protection here, right? So we have muscle encasing our abdominopelvic cavity, and that's helping to protect our organs such as our liver and our stomach and our kidneys. Those organs are really protected by a layer of muscle. And, you know, in addition to like physical movements, we also have posture. And then we can also say guard entrances and exits of the body. So that'll be an important job of your muscle system. As we look at the nervous system, we should remember the structures, the brain, the spinal cord, nerves, and then let's put our key communicating cell here called the neuron. Now, I would say the key phrase for the job of the nervous system is quick communication. A good communicator is going to listen, is going to think about that information, and then is going to generate some kind of response. And so the nervous system is collecting sensory information from the inside and the outside of the body. It's processing that information, and then it's directing some kind of response. We can also talk about this as helping to maintain homeostasis. So here's that word again. Remember, we will have a whole video talking about what we mean by homeostasis. So that's coming up shortly. When we talk about the endocrine system, this is using chemical messengers that we call hormones. So chemical messengers that are made in one tissue, released through the bloodstream, they're more widespread across the body. So here we have some important glands. A few that we'll mention here is the hypothalamus, pituitary. We have the pancreas has important endocrine function, the adrenal glands have important endocrine function, and there's others. Remember, we'll dig deeper when we study the system together on its own. Here's another example of structures that can belong to more than one body system. So for gonads, this would be either ovaries or testes. We think about these really as belonging to the reproductive system because they are involved in production of our gametes or sex cells, egg cells, and sperm cells. But gonads also produce important sex hormones. And so remember, hormones are part of the endocrine system. So we'll have what we call like primary endocrine structures, and then we'll have what we call like accessory or secondary endocrine structures. The job of the endocrine system is going to be long-term communication. I think actually we can just make that one word. So long-term communication. So this is going to be more long-lasting. So rather than a matter of seconds in the case of the nervous system, this is communication that can last for minutes, hours, days, weeks, months, and sometimes even years. So think about all those changes that are taking place in your development from infancy, toddlerhood, childhood, adolescence, adulthood. Those are all being coordinated by the endocrine system. So that's talking about a matter of days. We can then also, again, put that key word here, homeostasis. So we have two body systems involved in the maintenance of homeostasis, that be the nervous system and the endocrine system. As we continue, as we talk about cardiovascular system, here we have the heart, we have blood vessels. Now we have what are called arteries, which go to arterioles, which go to capillaries, which go to venules, which go to veins. And we'll see that you actually start with the heart and then go to the arteries, and then the vein takes your blood back to the heart. Again, we'll go into much more detail as we move into this body system specifically. And let's add blood there as well. That's going to be an important tissue that's part of the system. Now here, I like to think about the job of the cardiovascular system as transportation. Because the job of the cardiovascular system, this is like our primary shipping system, right? So we're going to move gases. So we're going to move oxygen and CO2 gases around the body. So oxygen from the lungs to the blood to the tissue, carbon dioxide gas from the tissue to the blood to the lung. We're going to have nutrients being transported this way. So again, those food goes into the digestive tract, the nutrients make their way into the bloodstream, and then from the blood out to your tissues as needed. As those cells are doing chemical reactions, we'll see waste products will move back into the bloodstream and then be processed out through the urinary system, typically, sometimes processed by the liver. And then we will see also in the cardiovascular system, this is how those hormones are going to be transported around the body. As we move into the lymphatic system involves what is called a lymph, and this is a fluid. We have what are called lymphocytes. So we're going to see the C-Y-T-E ending a lot. That just means cell. So lymphocyte would be the cells of the lymphatic system. If you've heard of white blood cells before, that's actually a lymphocyte is a special type of white blood cell. Or if you've heard of T cells are examples of lymphocytes. You're also going to have a network of lymph vessels. So you have in parallel with the cardiovascular system, these lymphatic vessels. And then you've heard before of lymph nodes. We also have lymph nodules. And we do have some lymph organs. And those lymph organs include like the spleen is a big one here. Now the key word or phrase for lymphatic system, I think, is defense. If you had a system that would be called the immune system, it would be the lymphatic system, but we don't actually say that. So the lymphatic system has the job of removing pathogens and remembering pathogens. So that's when we talk about immunity. This is defense is different from protection. Protection is like a physical wall, right? Defense is like mobilization of, a lot of times we use military analogies, mobilization of soldiers in this battle. Okay, respiratory system. You have, of course, lungs. You have the trachea and the bronchial tree. These are really the key structures. And this big job here is gas exchange. So that's getting the O2 into the body and the CO2 out of the body. As part of this, we'll also see pH regulation. pH is talking about how acidic or basic your solution is. So we'll see that here with the respiratory system. And to some extent, we have thermoregulation here. So if our body is really hot, we can exhale quite a lot of heat with our breath. Digestive system, mouth, stomach, small intestine, large intestine. The liver is part of this system. The gallbladder is part of this system. So we have several what we call accessory organs as well. Pancreas is an organ that we mentioned as part of endocrine, but it's important here as well. And here I'm just going to say nutrients. So we're going to obtain, we're going to digest, and we're going to absorb nutrients into the body. When we talk about the urinary system, we're going to have the kidney, ureters, bladder, and urethra. This body system is going to be like waste removal, but also key to this is to regulate fluid, electrolytes, and pH. So we'll see all of this is important function. So regulation of fluid, electrolytes, pH. So remember, it's going to be important in maintaining homeostasis. And our last body system here is the reproductive system. So what we see here are going to be gonads. So this can be either ovaries or testes. We're going to have genitalia. So here either vulva or penis. We're going to have some internal anatomy that's going to be important. So here you have important glands, you have uterus, you have other structures along those lines. And then I think we can also mention here your gametes, which is the fancy way of saying your sex cells. So these are either going to be your egg or your oocyte, and your sperm or your spermatocyte. Excuse me. The sperm is called the spermatozoa, is the plural form. Spermatozoan is the singular form. And the job of the reproductive system is, let's just say, make more humans. But we also would see as part of that is development and maintenance of what we call secondary, this is my shorthand, secondary sex characteristics. So these are the differences that you might see in body hair distribution, that distribution, height, sound of voice, several other characteristics that we would consider secondary sex characteristics. All right, that was a long video. Thanks so much for sticking with me. Stay tuned for video number 3. And as always, take care of yourselves and each other.